I just got a good glimpse of myself. Hello!
Welcome to Alpha Book Club. I'm Hector Navarro. And as always, our Nerdist editor-in-chief, Rachel Heine, as well as Maude Garrett. Give them a round of applause. Give them a round of applause. And hello to our Alpha community. You guys and gals make the show what it is, and we love talking with you all. This month, we're reading The Princess Bride.
That's me!
By William Goldman.
I'm pretty, aren't I? I'm
the prettiest.
Oh, I'm supposed to be modest as well and go horse riding.
Yes.
Mm-hmm. And yeah, I'm like, Robin Wright, not Robin Wrong.
You're a manic princess dream girl.
A little bit, a little
Boom.
Bit.
Boom!
I like that. That's a good saying. Guys, we are in costume this week. Obviously. We had to switch things up. We were going to do a costume thing next week, but we've got a super special announcement for next week at the end of tonight's episode. So be sure to stick around. I'm going to stop waving this thing around. I'm going to spill some wine because it's going to be a good one.
You're a wizard at that.
Yeah, you're a wizard.
Hello.
Okay. All right.
Mocked me once, never do it again.
Oh, boys in their swords.
As you wish.
Yeah, guys, we're reading The Princess Bride. We're reading part three. This is our third week of it.
Sorry, I was away last week. I was tending to the people of Florence.
That's right. How was
I
that?
I like you to visit the castle grounds.
You were overseeing a wedding? How was that?
Boo! No, it was fantastic. It was
that part finally happened in the book.
I know.
Was great.
In the book.
In the book. Yeah, everybody in the chat, say hi to them. DeMarco draws has parentheses applause up there. That's very nice. It's very nice. Lost the number says, this is not a drill. The moderator says, ha, they actually did it. Which is really
good.
I've had this in my
closet for like 3 or 4 years now. Yes. And I finally got to wear it. Actually, yeah, it has been 4 years. And I've worn it once.
Aww.
Now twice. So I was ready to go with
it. So worth it.
Yeah.
Totally worth it, right?
Just keep busting it out now. Just like wear it to parties and stuff.
Well, I wore it to the Ren
it's
Fair.
Wearable.
And everyone was like, oh, Cersei. And I was like, God damn it.
Yeah,
I was like,
happens.
Got. Damn it.
Got.
Game of Thrones.
Mm-hmm. That's pretty good.
Gotcha.
That's pretty good. DeMarco Dress says, wave your sword, Hector. No. I don't want to knock anything over. We're going to do a real important show here.
Viz Dumb says, his name is Hector Navarro. He has a father. Prepare to cry.
That's right. Oh. Except for Rachel, who's a badass. I won't cry.
I cried. I teared up last week, and then there was another opportunity for tears, and I decided no.
The second story I told was Andre the Giant loved shooting The Princess Bride because he felt like one of the guys.
I know, I love that.
He felt like he wasn't being
looked
at.
But that's so Fezzik, isn't it?
It's very Fezzik.
And that was really sweet, but I felt like if I were to cry two times.
Check out my cool boots.
These are mine.
Ooh, look at that.
I have toes.
As we show a clip. Look at my cool boots. Yeah. Look at that.
He
this is
great.
The real deal.
Yeah, man. You
Sorry,
are.
Sorry, I got right in the middle of.
I feel like I'm cheating a little bit. I'm wearing leggings, but you guys are wearing full period attire, but I think
great.
It all works.
You look dread pirate Robertsful. So. Mm-hmm. I was going to say dreadful, and I was like, that's not a compliment.
Dreadfully
no, it's not.
Cool. Pirating.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, sure.
So, what happened last week? Because I was not here. My apologies.
Well, we ran over the second part of the book. Let's get a little background. We got some background, speaking of, on Inigo Montoya.
Yeah.
On Fezzik, which was absolutely, this thing's in the way, which was absolutely lovely because we were talking about it right before the show started. You learned stuff about the characters.
I mean, I kind of knew about the purpose of Inigo Montoya. Like, obviously, the sixth man killed his father, but you didn't really know why.
Mm-hmm.
And you don't know, like, the extent of his training, and you don't really understand the whole backstory of Inigo and Fezzik as well. Like, I didn't know that his parents basically were show mum and dad, and they, like, you know, took over his whole life to train and fight him.
Fezzik's mom had that great line, life is pain.
Mm-hmm. Yes, she was the one who
who said it, and then they gave it to Wesley in the film.
You can tell, I mean, especially in the last section and this one, a lot of the dialogue from the film, I mean, it's word for word.
Yes,
a lot
I love that.
Which is really great.
Yes.
Well, it's like we're reviewing the book by William Goldman, but at the same time, we're also reviewing the screenplay by William Goldman because we're doing that compare and contrast.
Yes.
Like, we're comparing and we're seeing what was cut, and I think I agree with basically every decision that was made so far, like, in terms of translating it to
the
a screenplay.
The movie is superior in every way.
I would say
the
so.
The way that they did from the book going into the scene where Inigo is, like, restless trying to fight the Red Pirate Roberts, like that whole reading it and then seeing it, knowing how it came to life was so rewarding.
Yeah.
And I was like reading it as if I was the characters from it, and I just thought, oh, it was such a good moment. Yeah,
it was great.
You get this sort of internal monologue for all of these characters that we see a lot in the dialogue, and we see it in their performances and how they, you know, even when Humperdinck is tracking...
Humperdinck!
...is tracking them, mm-hmm. and he says, you know, I okay, Powder, I'd bet my life on it. But yeah. in this, you get him solving it very quickly before they get to that. So I like... Yeah. Then that's sort of what happens a lot in books, and we talked about this last week with The Girl on the Train, mm-hmm. which I don't know if you read that or saw the movie, but...
Apparently the movie was a very condensed and different version to the book.
Yeah, and it's, well, it's a lot of her inner monologue, so it's from her perspective, and so
yeah.
by
it's
adding
with
that...
Batman comics, it's tough. Batman comics are awesome because you're inside the Dark Knight detective's head as he's solving a crime, and it's rad, or like Daredevil. One of those, it's just like a great film noir, like, you know, she came strolling through the door.
Yeah.
Like, that stuff is great. Can you not take me seriously with this wig?
No,
I'm
trying. Side note, if you like that, one of the books I want to put up at some point, I think I did before, is The Dresden Files, because it's supernatural.
I'm so keen.
Noir.
I'd be down.
And
it's
sort of like, it's like, she,
I'm keen to read it.
She walked into my room, you know, like, it's
love
the
it.
Whole thing. I love that. But yeah,
love
it's,
it.
We also talked about getting the background on all those characters, especially
so
seeing
yeah,
where
the Cliffs of Insanity,
the
loyalty
fight, of
the yeah
of Inigo from his father, and
yes.
that he grew up with someone who was so honorable, and so you kind of see like
yeah.
you get that in the film. You know that he's an honorable man. He just, I mean, a Mandy Patinkin, but
it's, I think especially Inigo's backstory was so rewarding. He's my favorite character in the story from the movie and still the book. And so to have that filled in, to have those lines where, like, he was poor, his mom left him when he was young, they didn't have any money, it was, like, hot summers or whatever, and he was so
but
incredibly happy
wasn't,
because he loved his dad.
Yeah,
like,
but I love
yeah.
it. It's like, so he's so poor, but he's turning down work because
yes.
it's not about the money.
Yeah.
It's about
the
challenge.
Passion.
It's about
yeah.
the passion
the
of the work.
Artistry.
You know, and what he went through with the Count, a.k.a. the Six-Fingered Man, what Inigo went through was so great. We get to Fezzik's backstory. Some similar stuff. It wasn't as strong for me, but still, like, you love that character so much.
Yeah.
And you can see how both of those characters end up working for Vicini and being super loyal to him.
Well, they
you know?
Balance each other out so well, like
yeah.
having the brains behind the brute,
yes.
you know, force. I do get that dynamic more than what I got from the movie.
Mm-hmm.
The movie just seemed like he was bossing everyone around and they were just going ahead with it for a paycheck. But now, you know,
yeah.
it's not about the money.
Did
it's
they
about
actually,
camaraderie. It's about
and we
fulfillment.
Get, and we get more of that in this section.
Mm-hmm.
So that was last week. We got right up to there and he yep. was about to go fight Vicini.
Yeah.
And we were even hoping like, ooh, is there going to be backstory for Vicini? But there wasn't because
there wasn't.
We don't need any. It's just Wally Shawn. You're
well,
good to go.
Well, he talks himself
fine.
Up so much anyway that you
true.
Get the whole exposition
he's
through his
insecure,
dialogue.
He's an insecure but smart guy. Like
he just says he's a genius.
Yeah.
I'm smarter than anyone. I always mm-hmm. have been, I always will be, and that's how I operate business, and that's what's going down now.
And that's
that
his fatal flaw, too,
the
is
first
that arrogance.
His overconfidence
yeah.
is his weakness. His fatal flaw.
Yeah.
Anyone
oh,
drinking
man.
Brandy tonight? Ask lost the numbers.
Drinking wine.
I don't think I've had brandy.
Not with iocane mm-hmm. powder, although I've spent my life building up a tall.
I mean, this section, when he takes on Vicini, was very much like word for word
yes.
in
mm-hmm.
the film.
Yep.
And it was so funny. I want to read this section. Does anybody want to read with me? Yeah. Just do a quick little section.
Yeah, well, mm-hmm. should you have the man in
what
black
page?
Reading as the man in black?
Man in black as the man in black. I'm looking at 179. I'll
okay.
read Vicini.
I'll narrate.
Oh, thank you so much. Mm-hmm. Okay, fantastic.
What was it?
179.
Yeah.
I want to start with the Sicilian only smiled
yes.
at the outburst.
All right, everyone good?
Yeah.
You can read along if you've got this book. Copy 179. Mm-hmm. The Sicilian only smiled at the outburst. Then a strange look crossed his features, and he pointed off behind the man in black.
What in the world can that be?
He asked. The man in black turned around and looked.
I don't see anything.
Oh, well, I could have sworn I saw something. No matter.
The Sicilian began to laugh.
I don't understand what's so funny,
said the man in black.
I'll tell you in a minute,
said the hunchback.
But first, let's drink.
And he picked up his own wine goblet. The man in black picked up the one in front of him. They drank.
You guessed wrong.
Said the man in black.
You only think I guessed wrong.
I can say things. We can all say it exactly how
yeah.
it is in the movie, right?
It's great.
Sorry.
Yeah.
The Sicilian said, his laughter ringing louder.
That's what's so funny. I switched glasses when your back was turned.
There was nothing for the man in black to say.
Fool!
Cried the hunchback.
You fell victim to one of the classic blunders. The most famous is never get involved in a land war in Asia. And only slightly less well known is this. Never go in against the Sicilian when death is on the line.
Do it.
Oh my God.
That's
so funny.
He was perfect. Quite cheery until the iocane powder took effect.
That's great.
Oh, yeah.
And then even that line is really, really funny in the book.
Yeah, it was really well written.
Jesus Christ, Wallace Shawn's little delivery of laughing and then pulling it, like, just blows it out of the water. Like, so great. So great.
Actually, you know what? That particular part, how that dialogue, like when you see the actor read, when you read the lines and then how they interpreted them and how they say them, I felt really resonated in a part much later in the book. And I do want to talk about this scene a lot because I think they did a really good job. The machine.
Yep.
When Wesley, I'm going to jump way forward, so sorry about that. But when you see Wesley in the machine and the count, the six-fingered man, you know, please, for my research purposes. And he's talking so quietly and delicately.
Yeah.
Knowing that he's getting immense pleasure. And I love the hearing more about what the count's desire for pain is. And, you know, so softly saying, I'm sorry, but for research purposes, I need to know, how are you feeling? You know.
On a scale of 1 to 10. Yeah, all of that stuff is great. That stuff is great.
Like, I really,
there he is.
He's so good.
And that's, isn't that Christopher Guest?
That is absolutely Chris Guest.
I love that it's Christopher Guest because if you've seen literally
Oh my gosh, we just quoted that pretty much word for word. I'm so happy.
You see a lot more torture beforehand and how Wesley is getting through it.
Yeah,
and
I love
really
that.
Liked that too. And
the
he
detachment.
Sort of harkens back to his description of Buttercup when he's talking, recounting how he survived the Dread Pirate Roberts and how he described her and her wintry skin and everything, and that Autumn he's hand. Living in that place, mm-hmm. which I think is a nice, like, sweetness to this, that their relationship is so complicated, and it's true that she has hardened her, and I want to talk about sort of what happens between them because it's very different. Even though it's almost word for word, I feel like the reasoning and what she says to him is so much colder in this, where she says,
I
can live
well.
Without love.
Yeah.
But I think that their relationship, because they didn't know each other that well, because they were so young, because it was such infatuation, that it takes longer for her to realize what's happening.
Well, she even said that. I think there's a moment where she's like, you know, I thought I loved you when you know, when you were my farm boy, but then I realized that was only small compared to when I saw you in the fire swamp and you removed your mask. No, but that still was only infatuation. But now that I've lost you, now that
it's
I had you.
Similar to her little speech when she first knocked on the door.
Yes, I thought I loved you until 15 seconds ago.
Yeah, and now I love you 10 times that.
And
all that, and
then
that
had nothing on where she is now. So this love knows no bounds.
That was, to go back to the machine for a second, that part in the movie is not my favorite part in the movie.
That's because we watched it when we were kids and it's torture.
Yeah, but not just that, but like, I don't, it's not that I necessarily check out at this part, but my favorite part of The Princess Bride is when the Dread Pirate Roberts Wesley is going through the first three villains.
Yes,
love that whole section, the sword fight to the Vicini scene. And then I really love the ending when the heroes kind of come together and stuff. And I also love Miracle Max, but what I'm saying about that section is it's just not super as effective to me as the other sections of the movie. Reading the book, though, there is more build up to what that torture. There is more build up to the machine, so that once he actually is being tortured and he's screaming in agony, and you know that everything that came before was nothing because he threw his brain away or whatever he says, he made his mind go away. It's much more effective, and it was really, really interesting, like you're saying. So, like, I think it's just going to make on a repeat viewing that whole section of the film, like, that one more that much more engaging for me. That I'm going to be like, oh, you guys, you don't know what he went. Like, this hurts a lot.
The fact that they've been breaking his skin and burning him at one stage, doesn't he, like, pour oil on his hands and light his hands on fire?
And he was just, like, cool with it and acting like, oh, it hurts, oh, when he really just made his brain go away. That's crazy.
Can I read the scene?
You got it highlighted in your
bag. Well, it was really good. 265. There's two. Both of the passages I picked in this are like super bleak, so I'm really sorry.
Oh, I love it.
Very different for me.
That's why we drink wine on the show, Rachel. Yes. That's why we drink wine.
Do you enjoy the torture scenes? Because I know that you want to eat someone one day. So,
No. I said that I would possibly. I'm not gonna get back into
it. Keep digging that hole, Rachel. Keep digging that hole.
But
the smell of charring flesh, does that excite you?
No.
Like
I think
mesquite?
I think
lunchtime
no, ew.
Snack.
Gross.
You guys are. Oh, you know, you like it raw, like
gross.
Rare, right? A little bloody.
Ew, you're gross.
Like sushi.
When the mutton's
it's
just
that
like,
it's just that it looks good on the show. Anyway,
okay,
so
it just falls right off the bone.
I think the way that the way that this was written.
Hang on a second. Sorry, Rachel. DeMarco Draw says, Aussies are great, but it disturbs me that they are all almost super good looking and extremely fun and cool. Are there no ugly Aussies?
I do agree with that.
No. I'm like a four in Australia. Yeah.
That's not possible.
I heard, I have a friend that moved to Australia.
Inconceivable.
And I heard that because everybody is very Chris Hemsworthy and Maude Garrity, good looking, blonde and tall and statuesque, that like a short brown person would like clean up there.
Yeah.
Is that the
case?
Oh,
yeah, yeah, yeah. You would, you know how like Australians like to surf? Yeah. You will literally surf through the
I should have visited Australia when I was single. Oh, well. All right. All right. That's what happens. That's so funny. Surf through what? Did you make yourself laugh?
Yes. Okay, great. I was like, don't finish that sentence. The whole time I was speaking, don't finish the sentence. Yeah. So I decided to end it on poo.
Anyway, Rachel, the section, the bleak section.
I'm going to read this very dark scene now. Mm-hmm. But I just thought that it was really powerful. And the other one I picked is kind of a bummer, too. But so he's getting ready for the machine, and the wheel is going to spin very fast. It says, "But Wesley, as the lever moved, took his brain away. And when the machine began, Wesley was stroking her autumn-colored hair and touching her skin of wintry cream. And then his world exploded because the cups were everywhere. And before they had punished his body but left his brain, only not the machine. The machine reached everywhere. His eyes were not to control and his ears could not hear her gentle, loving whisper. And his brain slid away, slid far from love into the deep fault of despair, hit hard, fell again, down through the house of agony into the county of pain. Inside and out, Wesley's world was ripping apart and he could do nothing but crack along with it." I, like, that description
so
to me
great.
Was so, like, you get it, you hear the scream in the film, but that is, like, your mind, losing your mind. It's not physical pain. It's not, I mean, you do lose, you know, 1 year of your life away, but it's like the horror of, you know, telepathy
or,
you know, when you look in Legion or in Preacher or things like that where they talk about, the word of God or having those powers, and that's like literally that's all you have is your sense of self and your mind.
Yeah.
You can get over physical pain, but your that emotional mental pain is like something we can't even really grasp.
I'll say this about this section versus week two. This is week three. Week three, I may not have enjoyed the actual plot and what was happening in the story as much as week two, where we got Inigo and Fezzik, but William Goldman's writing is getting better.
Yep.
It's so descriptive. It's so beautiful. The way that he describes Buttercup's feelings towards Wesley. There's a couple passages where I was like, that's romantic as hell, man. This might still be a little bit of a weird relationship, Wesley and Buttercup, everything they went through. But there are some lines where I'm just like, man, that is such good writing. Just such descriptive language.
Oh,
and it's so good.
Did you notice in this one, there were far less parentheses?
Yeah.
If any, not many.
Did it take you longer to read? That's why? You noticed? Yeah.
Yep.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Did you guys try to go to the website?
Yeah, I did.
Nope. So it's down.
Yeah.
It doesn't exist, but I'll bring it next week. I found
what you're referring to is the reunion.
The reunion
of Wesley and Buttercup after she pushes him off and she's like, "You can just die for all I care," and he goes, "As you wish." She jumps down. I don't even remember that scene in the movie, but I guess they did cut it after she pushes him over. Because William Goldman has this famous section in the Princess Bride book where he says,
"Oh, Wesley, Wesley.
Wait.
Yeah. What have I done? The ADR on this
ADR.
Is awful.
Yeah. You can do ADR.
Oh, yeah, and he, at the end. So what we're going to do, guys, we're just going to watch the movie, and I'll act it out. We'll play each other's respective roles. That's fine.
Dead into the fire swamp.
Dun, dun, dun. Oh, whatever the music is for that one.
That
but so he says he wrote his own scene of the reunion.
Because the original S. Morgenstern never wrote it.
Yes.
So Goldman was like,
never
I
wrote
wanted
it. Well, it doesn't exist.
I know. Calm down, Maude. I know. It's not real.
You know what's funny? And I need to get this off my chest.
Okay.
He uses the book and then trims the fat for the screenplay. So as we've noticed, it's like we don't see a lot of the exposition.
Yep.
You don't, you know, it's very tightened and whoosh, whoosh, cuts around it. But the book in itself is saying that he's doing that to this S. Morgenstern's writing. So he's literally chucking a William Gold. I think I may have said this in the first week. Mm-mm. William Goldman on himself.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I could
so
see
he's,
that.
He's cutting off the bullshit.
Yeah.
And just leaving the good stuff. So I want a William Goldman, by doing this again without that horseshit fabricated shit and just have the good stuff, which was in the movie.
Yeah.
But the good stuff came from this stuff. So this is almost like a draft. And also I feel like that's what writing a screenplay versus writing a novel You do have to get to the point so much quicker. It's the same thing as like writing an article or something. If you don't have the point of what you're trying to say, an article or an essay or anything like that, if you don't have it right away, you lose the audience much quicker, I think, in a movie or an essay or anything like that than you would in a book where you go, oh, well, the first couple, it takes a while, but it's building.
Oh, you got to watch
it. Or a TV show, too,
it gets better
sometimes.
In the second season. Yeah. Oh, I got to watch a whole fucking season of this thing before. Yeah. But a movie's like, you got 15 minutes before somebody checks out, you know, at the most.
And they're like,
so.
I hate this movie.
But what are you saying, Maude? Are you saying that William Goldman knows that the extra
Why couldn't he just write the actual Princess Bride?
Right. He did. It's the movie. Because he also wrote that screenplay.
Because you get to see it in the movie. And you get to have people performing it.
Yeah.
So they're bringing that element to it on the page. You have to show that a little bit more.
Don't want the horse shit in it.
Which horse? Which
then we've got the movie.
Yeah.
You want to cut the fat, then the version of that literally is the movie that William Goldman wrote the screenplay for.
Oh, he's and, so handsome.
And looking up, Carrie, and looking up the history.
I know, it's the which wouldn't work on almost anyone else.
What, that mustache?
I didn't put my hair.
Yeah, that tiny.
Look at you, Rachel, it's you, it's
him
me.
And John
I
Waters,
need a belt.
That's it.
Shit.
Yeah.
I need a good belt.
I'm having a sad moment, if that's fine.
She looks, I watched, so I did watch this last week.
Yeah.
And I'm going to watch it again this weekend. Yeah. I bought it again. I'm sure I have the VHS somewhere, but I was just stunned by how young they all are.
Mm-hmm.
And everything that I kind of breezed through as a child, I think, watching it again. And I've watched it as an adult many times too, but just being so in this and watching it and their performances, and especially Robin Wright, I was just like, of course everyone did everything for you. Like, she's so incredible in it.
Yeah. When I was looking up the history of the reunion scene, because the website's down, I just look, and people like made little web pages where they're like, okay, this is what happened. Yeah. People did write in a letter asking for the transcript of the reunion scene.
Yep, this is going to piss you off so much.
And people would send back a fake like letter saying that they were having legal troubles. Like, it was all fake in the fake world.
Yeah.
That the publishing house would send to fans, which is pretty cool. I think it's a cool thing. Like, if you actually had that, if you got that thing bounced back and it said, like, oh, we would have sent you the reunion scene, but unfortunately we're all tied up with the Florin estate and the S. Morgan. Like, I think that's a neat little thing.
I love it.
But there was even a website that I was looking up that was detailing all of this. Even that website was like, you know, if you've seen the movie and you still haven't read the book, like, somehow the book is still even better than the movie. So be sure to check out the book. And I was just like, wait. Look, we all agreed. And I got two bookworms over here to agree. The best example of the movie's actually better than the book is The Princess Bride.
Yeah.
There's no debating it.
Yeah.
There's no debating it. I'm reading the book. And I'm reading the stinking book. And the notebook. Okay, yeah.
Notebook.
Ryan Gosling.
Yeah, there was another one that I...
Rachel McAdams.
Yeah. Picked last week.
That's
White Oleander. How dare you?
Cool. I'm kidding.
Oh, Ender's Game is so bad.
Sorry. That's mean. I read
John
one
Carter
sitting.
Might be better than the book.
No,
not that anybody cares. So then.
Underrated.
I agree.
Yeah.
I agree. I would be down to read John Carter of Mars, The Princess of Mars from 1912. That book is short, fun, super racist, and it's crazy. It's really great.
Can I read another sad scene?
Yes.
Of course.
It's a short one.
Where are we in? What section is this?
Do you need more than one?
Do you need a setup?
Do you need a...
One of you read it.
Okay, Maude's in it. Maude's in it. Guys, she's got to pick up the book she threw on the ground.
Yep, that's like my life. What page?
219.
Pinkish, she says, so weird rewatching this movie after finishing House of Cards.
Talking about
Robin Wright. Yeah, probably.
I would start...
If that's weird, go see Wonder Woman. Your mind will be blown.
She's so good in it. Yeah. I'm so good in it.
Start with the Come Along My Princess through to Out of Sight.
Hold on. So this is with
Bottom
Wesley.
Bottom of 219.
This is with Wesley and... Mm-hmm. Okay, so do you want to play Wesley? I'll play Princess Buttercup and you narrate?
Yeah, sure.
219.
219. Okay.
Yep. From No Need? No.
We can do a longer one. Let's do The Truth. So I'll start with The Truth.
Great.
The Truth, who's narrating Hector?
Said Wesley.
Is that you would rather live with your prince than die with your love.
I would rather live than die, I admit it.
We are talking of love, madam.
There was a long pause, then Buttercup said it.
Yes. I can live without love.
And with that, she left Wesley alone. Prince Humperdinck watched her as she began the long cross to him.
Ooh, who's doing him? I guess
you
I
are.
Know. When we are out of sight,
he said to Count Rugen,
take that man in black and put him in the fifth level of the Zoo of Death.
The Count nodded. For a moment I believed you when you swore.
I spoke truth. I never lie.
The prince replied.
I said I would not hurt him, but I never for a moment said he would not suffer pain. You will do the actual tormenting. I will only spectate.
He opened his arms then for the princess.
He belongs to the ship Revenge,
Buttercup said.
He is...
She began, about to tell Wesley's story, but that was for her to repeat. But that was not for her to repeat.
A simple sailor. I have known him since I was a child. Will you arrange that?
Must I swear again?
No need,
Buttercup said, because she knew, as did everyone, that the prince was more forthright than any Florinese.
Come along, my princess.
He took her hand. Buttercup went away with him. Wesley watched it all. He stood silently at the edge of the fire swamp. It was darker now, but the flame spurts behind him outlined his face. He was glazed with fatigue. He had been bitten, cut, gone without rest, had assaulted the cliffs of insanity, had saved and taken lives. He had risked his world, and now was walking away from him, hand in hand, with a ruffian prince. Then Buttercup was gone, out of sight. Wesley took a breath. He was aware of the score of soldiers starting to surround him, and probably he could have made a few of them perspire for the victory. But for what point?
Aww.
Wesley sagged. Come, sir, Count Rugen approached. We must get you safely to your ship.
We are both men of action,
Wesley replied.
Lies do not become us.
Well spoken, said the Count, and with one sudden swing, he clubbed Wesley into insensitivity. Wesley fell like a beaten stone, his last conscious thought being of the Count's right hand. It was six-fingered, and Wesley could never quite remember having encountered that deformity before.
Mm.
That scene is so tragic.
Section six, the festivity, sorry.
Yeah. And I want to go to sleep. Keep reading.
What a bummer, Rachel.
I know, I'm sorry. But I will say that the thing, and we've talked about this a couple of times, but William Goldman, not so much a fan of the ladies, it feels like.
Mm-hmm.
And so I think one of the key points in the film that really makes it better for me, because a lot of the humor is there and everything, is that Buttercup is not this much of a jerk.
Yeah.
In,
I feel like,
know?
Yeah, Billy, he has had his heart broken and he's taken
maybe,
it out in the book.
Maybe.
Possibly.
Yeah. I was waiting for the part in the book where Buttercup said, the reason I went through with this deal was to spare Wesley's life.
Mm-hmm.
I would be fine with dying or being married to somebody that I didn't love, mm-hmm. or being unhappy for the rest of my life as long as Wesley was alive somewhere. And it didn't happen. And I feel like it happened in the movie. I feel like there was a line that she said, even right when she was being taken captive, something akin to like, I will be fine, I just want Wesley to live. And I'll, you know, as long as
did
you don't
Did she almost say it to Humperdinck?
I think so.
She says it later, I think, yeah. And actually it does happen in the book, but it's more clear in the movie that she says, will you promise not to hurt him? So she is trying to save him.
Will you promise not to hurt him?
What was
so,
that?
So he gets sent to the pit of despair / the Zoo of Death, which I thought was interesting that the Zoo of Death ended up becoming, we had the albino come in, which is really fun.
He always has the chap lips.
Yeah, the chap lips and kind of shrugging and doing this and doing that. So that was fun. And that was pretty much, I mean, what else happened in this section, I feel like? Can we scroll down a little bit? I don't know if that's, I feel like that's pretty much it.
It's they go through they have the face-off with Vicini.
Mm-hmm.
They go through the Humperdinck tracks them, and so we get some more of
rodents of unusual size.
Yeah, the fire swamp.
Super scary.
The sand.
Better in the book. There was
the
more of them in the book.
Better in the book. As soon as they mentioned capybaras, I was like, ooh, this is real. I was like, you're trying to make this a real animal, and I love that.
They seemed faster. They described them as super fast and much more
hunting
agile. Pack.
Not a guy in a suit.
That's not a guy in a suit. What?
Oh, okay. That's very sweet. So then the Count was torturing them. And then there was another classic William Goldman interruption. Where
still annoyed. All used to it. One guess.
Yeah. Some of his interruptions are tough because I do so have the grandpa's voice in my head.
You do it so well.
So that when
your precision's been spot on this whole time.
That's okay. So when we get to
I love it.
When we get to William Goldman's interruption, where he's describing like the reunion scene and if you want to write and do all this other kind of stuff, and also what he describes as like what S. Morgenstern had written as like X number of pages of like setting up for the festivities, all of that stuff, like it does get a little bit like
tedious.
I'm in the story, man. It's tedious.
I know it's in the story and you've got the role going and then it's like, oh, 1 second, you're like, no,
it's fun because it's like it's stuff you don't I feel like it's fun because it keeps you on your toes. Because I haven't read a lot of fantasy stories like this, mm-hmm. a lot of adventure stories like this. But I feel like it's the type of writing that you don't expect in that type of story. So it's jarring a little bit.
Yeah.
But it's not necessarily like cool.
I don't want to be taken out of something. I read fantasy to escape, and this is like break. You know,
and this is a guy telling you, isn't this fantasy story great? Let me tell you about this fantasy story. And it's like, cool, you better really like that guy to have him tell you that story for hours.
That's the thing is, I don't hear Peter Falk in my head when he interrupts, because the way that he speaks.
No, I hear William Goldman.
This is a jerk.
Yep.
He's not a nice guy. He's pretty arrogant. Mm-hmm. I feel like he's the Vicini of his own life. Mm-hmm. And thinks he's very clever. I do like the conceit of it and the format, because I do agree that some classic fantasy, not all by any stretch, but we talked about Lord of the Rings.
Yeah.
If you could go through some of which, I mean, you kind of do in the movies, but if you go through and it's like, hi,
the
they
parts.
All lived on a mountain and these are the elves that are important. These ones
anyway, everybody got distracted with this dude named Tom Bombadil for a while. But basically, don't worry about Tom Bombadil, and now we're back in the story. That would have been a great interruption to Tolkien if that happened. Stephanie Ray California, who I think last week or the week before was her first week. Welcome back, Stephanie. Said,
yay.
So are we against breaking the fourth wall in story form? That's a great question.
I mean, I'm usually a big fan of breaking the fourth wall because it is connecting with your audience, but it usually does it when A, you need clarification,
mm-hmm.
or B, when you know, for a comedy effect.
Yes.
I feel that he does it in the worst timing to explain the most redundant information, mm-hmm. and it's to say, oh, by the way, I'm just letting you know that I didn't write about this. It's like, well, you're fucking writing. I'm sorry, guys, I can't talk about this anymore.
Yeah,
no,
it's interesting. It definitely... I think when I looked up the background info on William Goldman, like writing The Princess Bride, like I think most writers, you write the scenes that speak to you the most first. So when he was envisioning the story, I'm sure that he wrote the scenes, you know, the scenes that stand out, your favorite scenes. I'm sure he wrote him facing off against Inigo Montoya, him facing off against Fezzik, you know, Wesley and Buttercup in the beginning. I feel like he wrote those things first, and then at some point in the true story of William Goldman writing this, he said, like, oh, I just came up with this device to be able to sort of bridge these scenes mm-hmm. together as a device of, like, me telling you this story or me abridging this other longer book.
Well, that's cheap and nasty.
It's cheap. It can be cheap. It can be nasty. I think that it's fine, especially, look, there's no better interruption than in the movie The Princess Bride. She does not get eaten by the eels at this point.
Perfect.
Like, that's perfect because it's so genuine and sweet.
But in this book, he harnessed the fact that as I was a child, I was really frightened of that moment. And to write that into the screen.
And that was a great moment in the book, too, a great
interruption.
Because
you're realizing it's a fantasy tale mm-hmm. that's being told via a book. Mm-hmm. So I like the movie break, like the
me
break
too.
Sweet
tale. Well, you have the sweetness and you have this kid who is you.
Yeah, mm-hmm. yeah.
And
when you were watching
it. Said that, too, where it's like you're Fred Savage, where you're like, what is this? Oh, is it scary? And
totally.
You know, it is for kids, but it's also...
And when the eels were there, I remember panicking as a kid. And when it cut out of it, I was like, thank you.
And when you hear when he says, no one kills Humperdinck, you're like, what?
Yeah.
And I do like that. That is one of the only asides in this story. Mm-hmm. It goes on way too long, and I stop. He clearly likes to... It feels like he thinks he's very clever. And looking, I want to get to what he's written that's in the front, because... He is very smart, but he's done some really great movies. Mm-hmm. But that idea should have been condensed, but I like the idea of it being the realization that life isn't fair. Some people learn it really early. Some people, like William Goldman, seem to learn it like too late and maybe like didn't have a lot of hardship in their lives. But, you know, some people learn really early and we've talked about this with other books, that your parents aren't always right, that things are not going to go your way, and that it's devastating sometimes as a child to learn that. And so to have someone like the magical Peter Falk help you through that instead of like all the horrible things that could happen to you as a child, teach you that, I think that makes someone all the stronger for it, to learn that and the nuance of that.
Mm.
And it works in the movie, and I like that he brought that up in this.
Yeah.
But I do want to bring up the movies that he's done, because we've talked about Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid, and we've talked about All the President's Men, but he also did Heat, y'all. Like,
he wrote Heat. Heat's a good movie.
Heat is so good.
Yeah, it's a great movie.
And Maverick and Misery.
Yeah,
and
I love Maverick.
Marathon
Mel Gibson's
Man.
Maverick. I love Maverick. It's a great movie.
And
great movie. Was that Richard Donner?
He also wrote Dreamcatcher. So he adapted Stephen King into Dreamcatcher, which is a bad movie, but I really enjoy it.
So hold on.
And
Heat,
some plays
Maverick,
too.
It sounds like a basketball match. What's
Maverick it? Is a movie that starred Mel Gibson and Jodie Foster.
It's a Western.
That was based on an old TV show, an American TV show from the 50s called Maverick.
I don't think I've seen one of those movies.
Wow.
That's why I'm on a book club show, not a movie club.
You want a movie
I
club
would
show?
Highly recommend...
Butch Cassidy and the Sundance Kid is one of the greatest movies of all time.
I would put All the President's Men above.
Okay.
Now, All the President's Men is with Hottie Redford?
Yes.
Great! See, yeah. I know shit.
So is Butch Cassidy with prime Redford.
Yeah,
I'm talking
prime Redford too.
Like grade A beef cut choice Redford.
That's true. That's a good point.
The face of an angel. The jawline of one.
Oh, I was just going to say
something about his movies. What about his movies?
Just that I think that he clearly, I mean, a lot of these, when you think about these movies, it's a lot of men.
Sure.
It's just, which is fine.
Sure.
But it's the same thing, and someone
it's a regular
said in the
Steven
comments,
Spielberg,
I think
this guy.
That, yeah.
maybe, okay,
oh,
maybe
boy.
I won't. All right.
Well, that was a...
Thank you for the one person that laughed at that.
Yeah, the whole thing. The Color Purple, though?
Yeah, uh-huh.
Yeah, Thrasho. And I know Dreamcatcher's not a good movie, but I enjoy it. But,
You just like Stephen King. You have Stephen King vibes.
Yeah, you just like Stephen King.
No, I like it because it's so bonkers off the wall, and it has, like, weird...
Was Nicolas Cage in that? I feel like he was
no,
in that.
No, it's, it's
like
Thomas
Cage
Jane
movie.
And...
Pretty much, then, Nicolas Cage.
Oh, were you talking about Dreamcatcher?
Yeah, Dreamcatcher. It's Thomas Jane.
Jason Lee, too, was in
that. Jason Lee's in it, and the guy from Homeland, and now I'm spacing on, and I love him, from...
Love her.
Stephanie
well.
Says,
anyway,
well,
doesn't
I'm
going to
quote this whole dang movie by the time
Stephanie says, do movie club show.
Yeah, I know. We'll just do a bonus. But
but they can only be movies that I choose.
They're
Star Wars.
Someone brought up House of Leaves in the comments, which I've brought up before. But if this framing device, I would be so interested. We need like 6 months to read House of Leaves because it's like a thousand.
House of Left.
It's like a thousand pages, and it's a story within a story within a story, and the writing goes all around the pages.
Cool.
And everything. It's very.
Sounds super boring.
It's really
kidding.
A thriller. It's really. It's not boring. It's really exciting.
Sounds like schoolwork.
It's not.
High
it's
school.
Really no.
All right, I'm just teasing.
Never
you.
Mind.
I'd read it. No, Rachel. No. Tell us about it.
No.
Tell us about the thousand page
book. It's fine. Let's
book.
Talk about the Princess Bride.
What's the thousand page book about?
It's fine.
Is it like Shantaram?
Is it like It?
No.
Is it like back
no,
in
it's
is
fine.
It like you get like flashbacks and stuff? Framing devices? Is it like Watchmen? The issue right in the middle, fearful symmetry, which is perfectly symmetrical.
No, it's nothing like any of those things.
Cool.
Can we play more of the movie?
Maude, I've got a list of the 500 greatest movies of all time. I'll get you that list so you can just start doing.
I know. I should have the Criterion collection as well.
Criterions are fine, but a lot of them are like, I watch them like, this is.
I need to watch
Way Before My Time
again. I think.
Oh yeah,
you watch
it's been a little bit. Never Ending Story.
Never Ending Story.
Yeah.
Story?
Yeah.
I had another section I wanted to. Do we want
to? Oh, cool. I used to have like recurring dreams about Falcor the Luck Dragon.
If I had any sort of fluffy dog, I would name it Falcor.
Fluffcore. What are we doing?
Rachel, do you want to be the booing woman?
Yes.
Okay, great. Please join me on page 235.
Oh, I so
Maude,
do.
Maude, you will be Buttercup as
Get
well,
out.
Of course.
Me?
Yeah, 235.
235.
Yep.
It's not like I've been practicing her this entire time.
Towards the bottom. They stood together on the castle balcony, accepting the cheers, the cries, the endless thunderous hip-hips, until Buttercup said...
Please, may I walk once more among them?
And the king said with a nod that she might... And down she went again, as on the day of the wedding announcement, radiant and alone. And again the people swept apart to let her pass, weeping and cheering and bowing, and then one person booed. On the balcony, watching it all, Humperdinck reacted instantly, gesturing soldiers into the area where the sound had come from, dispatching more troops quickly down to surround the queen, and like clockwork, Buttercup was safe. The booer apprehended and led away.
Hold on a moment,
Buttercup said, still shaken by the unexpectedness of what had happened. The soldier who held the boer stopped.
Bring her to me,
Buttercup said, and in a moment the boer was right there, eye to eye. It was an ancient woman, withered and bent, and Buttercup thought of all the faces that had gone by in her lifetime, and this one she could not remember.
Have we met?
The queen asked. The old one shook her head.
Then why? Why on this day? Why do you insult the queen?
Because you are not worthy of cheers,
the old woman said, and suddenly she was yelling.
You had love in your hands, and you gave it up for gold.
She turned to the crowd.
It is true what I tell you.
there was love alongside her in the fire swamp, and she dropped it from her fingers like garbage. And that's what she is, the queen of garbage.
I
had given my word to the prince.
Buttercup began, but the old woman would not be quieted.
Ask her how she got through the fire swamp. Ask her if she did it alone. She threw love away to be the queen of grime, the queen of muck. I am old and life means nothing to me. So I'm the only person in all this crowd to dare tell the truth. And truth says, bow to the queen of fetulence if you want to, but not I. Cheer the queen of slime and ordure if you want to, but not I. Rave over the beauty of the queen of cesspools, but not I, not I.
She was advancing on Buttercup now.
Take her away.
Buttercup ordered. Oh!
Boo.
There's some good
muck.
Zingers in there.
Slime!
Filth!
Some good,
boo.
Good
boo.
Zingers.
The mole is right there.
It's also so glad her nightmares when her like baby was okay, dying was the scariest shit. Like your milk is poison. I'm dying now. I'm gonna die.
So is that one? No, it's because of you. Because you left the man you
love,
but I will die.
Yeah.
So that was the other bleak part I wanted to bring up, because that part is so dark. I'm so glad it's not. In the movie.
The nightmare was the booing woman. Yeah, the nightmare was the booing woman, and that was great in the film. It's
kind of like in Willow, where the queen turned everyone into pigs, and you slowly saw them like morph. That shouldn't have been in the movie.
No, there's a. Well, I do feel like in a lot of these movies, and last week we had such a great Twitter like conversation after the show about all of the kids' movies that we love, Neverending Story and Willow and Labyrinth.
Maybe are a little messed up, and that maybe
they're all messed
like,
up and
that
scary.
You can't, like we were saying, like Princess Bride Princess Bride's in a different thing altogether. But we were talking about movies.
It's a little bit more safe.
It's a little bit more safer. But we were talking about movies that influenced you when you were young, and maybe some of them might not even hold up, but they just had such an imprint on you when you were young.
Yeah,
you know?
And a lot of them are the nothing. The concept of the nothing, I feel like, haunts me to this day, because I'm afraid of like. Things that that are so big that you can't wrap your brain around. So
the concept of the nothing.
Yeah.
From
so that you're that you're disappearing.
Yeah.
And that there's nothing. That there's oblivion. So like deep ocean freaks me out. Deep space freaks me out.
I love it. I love
and
deep
death
space
because you don't understand it.
You can't wrap
your brain around it. And well, we'll download into robots is sort of what I'm hoping. But,
yeah. Cool.
Sure.
But that idea that everything would be gone, and it's not, it's like the rock monster says, it's not.
My teeth hurt thinking about that.
Oh, yeah.
The rock monster?
Yeah,
the eating the.
Yeah.
Very dumb aside, but I have friends who did this podcast called the Cinemarathon where we would, Hector, I think you would really love this, where we would watch all the movies in
a franchise.
A franchise
oh,
in
God,
one
it's my
day.
Favorite. And then I rank them. Oh, I love it.
Yeah.
I love it so much. I do it all the time.
We did Batman, and we started with Adam West and went all the way through The Dark Knight Rises.
That's right.
Included Mask of the Phantasm because
any
it was released.
Mm-hmm. I got it. I'm already on the same page.
We did The Neverending Story, and the third one has the rock monster with a bunch of child rock monsters riding motorcycles to Born to Be Wild.
Yeah,
yes.
That's true.
It's really, really bad.
No, I don't remember it being bad.
Terrible.
Yeah. I was nine.
But I loved it.
Yeah. I was not alive when the movie
came out. No, you weren't. Yeah.
Oh, shit.
But yeah, then the nothing, and then even the torture scenes in this, and some people in the chat were saying like the R-O-U-S's really freaked them out too. Mm-hmm.
They were perfect. I don't know about you. Oh my gosh, I can't believe this. Every time I watched the part where she fell into the quicksand, I would hold my breath.
Yeah,
and I'd see if I could hold my breath.
And that section in the book was like intense.
That was
turns
like
out
they
couldn't.
Went into it, and it's like sand getting under your eyelids, and it's just like oh.
And
shit.
And grabbing a skeleton arm.
Oh yeah,
yeah.
The wrong
thinking
wrist.
It was nope, and but then like, reaching again like.
When you imagine like if you did the maths behind the free fall, you know, the distance that you were doing per second, and the whole wave of the conversation, like whether that was just so quick or it just felt like she was falling so long.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
And then when he dove after, it's like oh my vine ran out. I've just got to kind of. Hope that I can get back
get
there.
Her and then get back.
It feels
yeah.
like it's like really deep, like center of the earth, kind of deep.
Yeah, that it just that maybe there's no end to it.
Well, that's what you
I think
hate.
It's all in psychological though. I think it's all psychological.
Well, it's like in D&D where it takes 7 hours to do like a 4-minute fight.
For sure. Yeah.
Yeah.
I get that.
Or
did you guys think as kids that like quicksand and lava were going to be way more for real threats as adults than they ended up being? I've never even been near quicksand or lava.
Oh my God, you're so right.
Like, quicksand was like in every cartoon, every movie.
Like, I was really afraid lava. That a volcano was going to erupt. Yeah. There were a bunch of stuff around everything LA, too. And I was oh, yeah, we're done for.
Yeah.
You had Dante's Peak, you had Volcano. When like, that up. Shit was real.
Yeah. Oh, my gosh.
And we were always playing pushing. The floor is lava because it was training for when the floor was actually lava. The floor was never lava.
No, it's never going to be
not
lava.
Yet.
Not yet. Global warming, right, guys?
Yeah, it's coming.
It's freaking hot in LA these past couple days, y'all.
Oh my God, it's someone, really hot. Oh, we're talking about, I don't want to get too distracted, but Labyrinth, Dark Crystal,
Watership Down.
Yeah, Watership
What's
Down
that
is,
one?
Watership Down is a great, we should not tell Maude what it is, just start watching it.
No, I'm good.
Watership Down is a delightful animated film with talking rabbits and farm creatures. Check it out. Check it out.
It's really fun.
Check it out. It's like a cross between Zootopia and DreamWorks Over the Hedge. Just really delightful. Just a fun time. Just a romp. Just a real romp.
Maybe Blonde. Not that
Secret
stupid.
Secret of Nim.
Oh, yeah. Secret of Nim. I love Come all on. Don Bluth. Someone, Come if on. You scroll up, someone said something that.
Yeah, Stephanie Canada says, how about the Pinocchio? Even the Disney version was messed up.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's terrifying. Never Turning into story. Donkeys.
Thrash Odin, the never-ending story. Is a deeply tragic movie.
Oh, no, I pulled my eyes out when the horse dies every time. That's quicksand.
Betray you.
What? Steven, are
Steven,
you kidding
what?
Me? Did the they, horse really die?
Did they actually kill
look
that horse filming that movie?
Now I need to know.
You better look, Steven, you better shut your mouth and look it up. Steven, you better. Steven, don't even talk to us, Steven.
He does the same thing with Milo Notice.
Yeah,
like,
no,
no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no, no.
Like Look, eight cats.
Y'all
want to
get real?
Died.
No,
y'all get real right now.
It really died. It
Let's
really
talk about
the
Land Before Time. Let's talk about the Land Before Time.
Petrie, poor Petrie.
The voice of Ducky.
Yep, yep, yep.
Judith Barcy.
Oh yeah, that was sad.
Child actor.
I know.
You're good, you're good. The horse didn't die.
Horse didn't die.
I don't want to know about Milo.
Well, Judith Barcy definitely was killed by her father, and it was really fucking sad.
That actually happened.
Really happened, for real. Can you get me some more as well? Guys, what'd you think about this section of the book? Thank you for looking that up.
Sword in the Stone.
And it's
a great
not
movie.
A little person that hung themselves. It's a crane in the background of Wizard of Oz. And it's not a ghost. It's a cardboard cutout of Ted Danson in Three Men and a Little Baby.
Brave Little Toaster, I will say.
Love that.
Brave Little Toaster is so good, and I used to have in my room, the blinds in my window would cast a shadow on the wall that reminded me of the air conditioner.
The air conditioner.
In the Brave Little Toaster, and it scared me.
Here's my pitch, Rachel.
Beyond words.
You tell me if you think this is a good idea. Live action remake of the Brave Little Toaster using CG to make appliances actually come to life.
No.
I think it'd be great. No. I think it would kill. I think it'd be great.
I'm sure it would make a bunch of money. But I don't think it
And
be
you can
good.
Make it on the cheap because you're literally shooting appliances and you're like, we'll CG this later.
I just think the way that they move and bounce around is so like wriggly and weird.
You make them CG, but I'm saying like at one point, I could just picture live action. No. There's an actual silver toaster in a kitchen and a little kid comes up and is going, and then as the kid walks away, eyes just happen. Just like in the movie,
I
and
love
a smile.
That scene.
I know.
Yeah, that's
I
want
to see
one.
It live action. I
Y'all
think
seen
be great.
Return to Oz?
No.
That one's scary too. Or The Witches? I love The Witches. So.
No way! Oh my God! I saw that way too young, and they Me took too. Their, oh my God! When
what
they took
that,
their wings
that,
off.
What's that movie with Chevy Chase? I think is in it, and Dan Aykroyd is the scary. Is it Chevy Chase? I'm thinking of. Dan Aykroyd's like a weird, like goblin mayor of like a weird, scary
it
Halloween
awful.
Town. What
is
was
it
that
Halloween
called?
Town?
Nothing but Trouble.
Oh, I don't think I've seen that.
Way too scary. Nothing but Trouble.
Oh my God, Aaron, your shirt. It's so good.
And look
I
at
like
her jacket
artist.
Too. Look at, turn around, look at that.
Oh my God, amazing.
Friggin' Antiope over there.
So Wonder Woman. Yeah, I feel like Princess Bride in the scheme of all of those movies, I definitely watched a lot of them too young, and I mean, formed a lot of things that I'm into now
witches
that were
is
super,
fucked.
Yeah, The Witches, I watched the movie first, then read the book. The book is, we should read some, I mean, we could do like a collection of Roald Dahl,
I mean,
but.
Oh, that would be, I would love to read Roald Dahl. I've never read
Roald
Dahl.
Dahl.
And that guy,
oh, I hear you. I'm still calling him Roald Dahl.
Roald Dahl? Maude.
Wow,
come on, Maude. You can't, are you basing
it
off of books or movies?
It gave you The Witches and
the books.
The books? Okay, well, I haven't read any of the books.
Okay.
What about The Twins?
Okay. I'll read
it. What about Charlie and the Great Glass Elevator?
I'd read that.
I didn't mind James and the Giant Peach, maybe.
I love James and the Giant Peach movie. That
movie's
great.
The movie, that's Henry Selick.
My name is James.
I hate it already.
James.
There are people if in Florin the city was very far away, and they're very, very far away from here. Very far away. I love that
movie.
The
Black Cauldron. You guys, okay.
What do we
the
got?
The Black Cauldron. Oh, I wish. Okay. I'm going to tweet it later. The Black Cauldron. Mm-hmm. I love Andy Serkis. He's a deeply talented person. He should have a million awards. Mm-hmm. The voice he does for Gollum is the voice of the little puppy in The Black Cauldron.
Boom.
Look it up. Same voice.
Okay.
I think it's Gertie is
Take
the
that.
Name of the puppy.
Take that, Andy Serkis. That's great.
Hey, if you could go to Florin or Gilda or any of these places, where I'm just reading off the order queue right now, but where would you like to visit most in The Princess Bride?
Look at that. Look at that map. That's gorgeous.
Wow, yeah.
Love it.
Florin, Gilda, the cliff of insanity. Mm-hmm. I was just in New Zealand, and every time I saw a cliff that was nice and high, I was like, look, it's the cliffs of insanity.
And then the people that you were with said,
of insanity.
God damn it, you're a nerd.
But now you're here.
Well, now you're in the right city.
Of course,
we're
all
planet. Well, you get paid to be that nerd, so that's great.
I'm with my people now.
That's great. What else? Okay, so earlier too, Stephanie from Canada was asking about Breaking the Wall, and she got a bunch of recommendations for books that had elements of breaking the fourth wall, as well as Deadpool, and she was asking, but are comics the same as books? And I'm like,
Ferris Bueller's Day Off, one of the better uses of breaking the fourth wall.
Absolutely,
yeah.
Absolutely.
That's true.
But, you know, it really, I think it comes down to, it depends on the project.
House of Cards, I will say, uses it too much, I think.
Really?
I thought a little bit.
Man, that pilot is so good.
The pilot is great. This last season is really good, and they have a moment in the last season where they break the fourth wall that's really great, and you're like, what the fuck? But
the
I think in the middle seasons where, like, three... I felt like, actually, you know what? I take it back. Because there was one episode or several that went by where he didn't talk to you. And then he was like, did you think I forgot about you? And you were like, yes, I did. So never mind. Ignore me.
I've got one last Princess Bride question that we may not even be able to ask next week. And you'll find out why soon. But if the Princess Bride gets remade.
No.
No.
Because Hollywood's going to touch it.
I don't
Hollywood
know,
touches
man.
Everything it should.
Yeah.
I feel like Princess Bride is like the first Godfather. It's like Jaws. It's like the first
Oscar
Star
Isaac.
Wars. They'll never remake that.
Inigo.
Every character.
Inigo.
As every, thank you.
Why do I always
Inigo
say
Montoya?
Inigo? Is it
I always
same?
Say Manny Patinkin instead of Mandy, so it's the same thing.
I honestly Inigo. Would actually cast Oscar Isaac as Wesley.
Really? That'd be great.
Because
but you
he
can't,
is hot.
You can't do that movie because Andre the Giant isn't alive anymore.
Yeah. There's,
and there's no other human on Earth.
The Big That's Show? The,
it's like, who? Come on. Big Show?
I will also say one quick thing about the actual language that I noticed, too, was in the dream, and but especially in the Fezzik section, it reminded me a lot of sort of modernist writing where you have stream of consciousness.
Yeah.
And when he's thinking and he's like, and he's rhyming and he's doing and it runs on and it runs on and it feels very much like what his inner monologue would be like. And the same thing with the nightmares. It feels like this never ending matter of fact, everything is horrible. This is the worst thing in the world that dreams feel like. And I thought that the writing here was really, really strong that I feel like I understand Fezzik and that I felt so sorry for him and that he was truly lost in a way that even if you were another character, you wouldn't be as lost as he was.
Oh, yeah, Fezzik and Inigo reunited, which is great, and they're going to go get business done, which
he
I love it.
He takes such good care of him.
Everybody?
Announcement.
Yeah. We have a very special announcement.
God, I'm so excited.
Maude, do you want to tell the internet what our special announcement is?
Oh, my God, I would love to. All right, we've got a super special announcement. For next week, we're going to have a guest in the studio talking about the last part of the book and also maybe what it was like shooting the film.
What?
Because it's going to be Wesley himself, Carrie Ulls. He's going to come in the studio. Carrie's going to come in for the last episode.
What?
He's going to come in here. This is why we had to dress up this week and not next week because it'd be fucking weird if we dress up next week. So he's going to come in and we're going to talk about it all. Holy shit, guys.
Guys, let us know if you've got questions for Carrie.
Yeah, please tweet us all of your questions. Yeah,
this is bucket list status.
I know. I'm so excited.
Oh,
we're going to talk about the film. He's a writer too. There's so much we can talk about.
I actually interviewed him on a red carpet once, really briefly because he was there for The Conjuring.
Very
I
cool.
believe it was because he's been working a lot there, and you know, it's great working with an Aussie director.
Yeah, James Wan.
And of course, the only thing I could talk about was The Princess Bride, so I'm glad I can actually do it without pissing him off.
Yeah, he's here to talk.
Yeah.
Like,
I want to respond to chat, guys.
Yeah.
Huh? Oh,
yes, it's true.
Oh,
yeah.
I'm only gonna ask about X-Files season 9. What? Come on,
also,
guys.
Also, seeing that, super round of applause for our producer, Aaron.
Yeah.
We're so excited. And we're all gonna lose our dang minds. And I don't feel like we can even tell anyone in the office because we're gonna have everyone who works here is such a nerd. It's gonna be like the most insane.
Try not to make out with a mod, says Thrash Odin. Oh my gosh. I'm also already sweating. Oh, you've got so many questions, T-Boys.
Yes.
Tyler, hit us with them, bud.
Guys, you're actually indirectly going to be chatting with him as well, so any questions that you have, we'll have the chat going. I know, I'm going to be like, farm boy, answer my question.
And then he'll say, if he says, ask you.
Oh my God. I will be coming out of this studio,
guys. Shut up. STFO, if he says, as you wish, one fucking time.
I'm going to be like, grab something near him.
Cool, guys, we can trick him into saying it. All we have to do is say, hey, so tell us about your book. What's the title? And then he'll say,
as you wish. Oh,
and he'll have said it. He'll have said the thing that we love.
Oh, my God.
That he says. I got to rewatch Men in Tights. I really do.
Yeah, we're going to have a lot of research to do this weekend. Yes. And also make sure that you guys share this out with all your friends. We have friends who like The Princess Bride. Tell them to tune in. They can sign up for...
We have a 60-day shipmates.
If you use, 60 days. If you use the code, it's what, Shipmates?
Shipmates. That's from the show Mothership.
Yes. Mm-hmm. From that you guys might know that Hector
hosts. Ships you not.
I'm on it sometimes.
But please, you know, get your friends into it because they can have 60 days free. They can watch the show. They can watch Mothership. They can watch everything that we do.
And then they can cancel the before they get charged. It's cool.
But
they
won't
it.
Because they'll have such a good time
Carrie.
Watching all of our shows. And Carrie. So please
carry up and
share it
come
out
over.
With everyone because the oh more God. That we have awesome people like this on, the more that we can bring more people
That's
on.
True.
So it's so Reckon. Cool.
And guys, also on top of all of that, send us photos of you reading or watching The Princess Bride. Please send us your photos of you guys dressed up.
Yes.
We would love to have them. And your homework this week, on top of being super, super excited because we're getting to talk to Carrie Elwes next week.
How do you say his last name?
Carrie Elwes.
Is it Elwes? We're
going
to have to find out.
Find out.
I hope he
Finish
doesn't watch this.
The oh, book.
We're freaking out.
Elwes.
Elwes with a W.
Elwes.
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 Oh,
Elwes.
I was using an up over here.
That's okay. Your homework this week.
Elwes.
Finish the book, The Princess Bride, y'all, and
finish
read
it.
Buttercup's Baby if it is in your edition, which is in some certain editions of the
is
book.
It an
yeah,
else?
That's a good idea. That feels
is
great.
Is it an else?
What's that?
Is
I think
else?
It is.
It
I'm
is.
Pretty sure
yeah,
it is.
Yeah, it's in the 30th anniversary.
Yeah. I just broke this. Okay. Feel
your
real bad. Oops.
Sword. I'm so going to watch it again, guys.
So don't forget, guys, we're also on Goodreads, so search Alpha Book Club and then come and discuss books with us. If you're interested in joining us via Skype on the show, just let Courtney know on Twitter at JoinTeamAlpha, and she's going to help move that process forward. Send us your recommendations to at Nerdist, at Geek and Sundry, or at JoinTeamAlpha, because we got another month coming up next month.
I think
month.
I know what I'm going to select.
I don't know if y'all know this. What do you want to give anybody
no,
a tease?
Next week.
We're going to hold on to that. But
see.
We need recommendations with the hashtag Alpha Book Club, so all of those places on the social media. And we're going to be voting on next month's book next week. And July might be a little bit shorter because of stuff like Comic-Con, possibly. So if it's a little bit shorter, send it in.
Yeah.
Great.
Oh, mine's so much longer.
This was so much fun. I'm going to wear this the rest of the night.
Yep.
Did you say don't?
Let's seriously.
You say don't do it? Do it?
Can we can we just do like a reading of the whole movie somehow?
Yeah.
Well, we were talking to, now that American Gods is back too, tweeted us if you've watched the show.
Oh, yeah.
We'd love
season
to
one's
do
over.
Different bonus episodes about the adaptations of stuff that we've read and talk about that. So let us know what you guys think, but we'll keep chatting with you. But Golden Compass out of Fiti.
Yeah.
We'll make it happen.
One day.
Curse the Cosmos says, I can attest it's so worth the money. I love this community so much.
Yay.
We love you guys.
So, so much.
Thank you guys for reading with us every week. Thanks for joining us.
So much.
The fact that we say this all
it's
the time.
Fun.
But
it's not
that
fair,
we get to do this is so much fun. I come in and I'm exhausted and then I'm like, yes.
You guys are getting Carrie Elwes. I said his name right and it feels good.
Carrie Elwes. That's right. Ooh, World
I'm
War
so
Z would be dope, T-Boys, and so would Murder on the Orient Express.
Oh, yeah.
Great options all.
We'll be doing this for all time until we get through every book that's ever been
ever.
Written.
Yeah. Whew, all right. Yeah.
So we will see you guys next week. We love you very much. As you
Carrie's
wish. Bye.
Oh, we should do the show As You Wish every time. Anyway.
Okay. As you wish. Bye.
Let's get